Admittedly, we can only ever be certain of death and taxes. With that caution in mind, though, it is safe to say there is abundant evidence that the once all-powerful Fianna Fáil party is sitting on the edge of a political precipice. Over the past decade, its share of the vote at general elections has been approximately half of what it had received for the previous 70 years, with its seats in Leinster House reduced accordingly. No less alarming for party supporters has been recent opinion polls. Admittedly, only reflecting a sample of the electorate's view on a particular day, the downward trend is unmistakable. Old Dev's creation is in deep trouble, and the Irish establishment's power brokers know it. In the 3 months since forming a government, Fianna Fáil has presided over confusion, fiasco, scandal and ineptitude. The list of political setbacks is lengthy, starting off with the forced resignation of a minister within days of the new Dáil sitting, losing another minister via a golf gate shortly thereafter, through to the appointment of highly paid spads on the same day as reducing pandemic unemployment payments, are only the more spectacular of many faux pas. Confused messaging has also been an ongoing feature of the Micheál Martin leadership, a problem exacerbated by the constant and apparently deliberate undermining of his position by the Fine Gael Taoiseach, Leo Varadkar, a situation that underlines the weakness of a party that is now in the invidious position of carrying responsibility but with reduced authority. Adding to his woes, the Taoiseach has powerful critics within his own party, because in spite of Mary Lou MacDonald's verbal attacks on Martin's performance, the Sinn Féin leader has been outdone in that field by certain Fianna Fáil TDs. Mark McSharry and Jim O'Callaghan are just two of several critics. Most outspoken, however, has been Éamon O'Keefe, grandson of the party's founder, who has bluntly called for his leader's replacement. The Galway West TD has repeatedly warned that after the next general election, only two large parties will remain, Fine Gael and Sinn Féin. Such undisguised discontent has fuelled a view that current leader Micheál Martin bears sole responsibility for the party's plight. Although he has certainly contributed to their distress, the malaise goes much deeper than one individual. Fianna Fáil has been in difficulty for several decades, with its failings disguised by a cunning ability to retain office through finding willing coalition partners. At the heart of their difficulty is a problem of identity, coupled with a lack of clarity of purpose. Sustained for decades by its ability to dispense favours rather than present and or represent an ideology, Fianna Fáil is now paying the price for its duplicity. Once it was seen as offering some degree of opposition to the strident laissez-faire policies of Fine Gael, and with a Labour Party wedded to a policy of coalition with the Blue Shirts, Fianna Fáil was able to gain significant working class support. Such illusions have been shattered over the past decades with a series of devastating disclosures. Charvet shirts in the diplomatic bag, brown envelopes in the Dáil Éireann, and untruthful accounts of personal dig-outs among the more spectacular. Any lingering illusions were finally laid to rest during the years of confidence and supply, while the party supported the Blue Shirts in their support of the harshest of neoliberal strategies. Conflicted between protecting the business interests of its wealthy backers and taking decisive measures necessary to guarantee the health and safety of working people, Taoiseach Martin knew for once exactly where he stood. Within 5 days of assuming leadership of government in June, his Minister for Health, Simon Donnelly, oversaw the reprivatisation of hospitals taken into state control at the outset of the COVID-19 pandemic. Add into this the inexcusable failure to deal with the threat to workers in food processing plants, failure to address the injustice done to Debenhams' former staff, and the state's refusal to treat COVID-19 as an occupational hazard, all clearly indicating that the party's commitment to the free market remains as firm as when last in office, as it oversaw the fiasco leading to the 2010 bailout, which cost working people so dearly. Elsewhere, the supposedly anti-treaty Republican Party has struggled with its foundation myth. Its commitment to maintaining the 26-county state with its institutional gravy train has required it to endeavour to retain partition at all costs. Few episodes illustrated this better than the aftermath of Leo Varadkar's identification of the changing tectonic plates in the six counties last December. Rather than recognise reality, the mealy-mouthed Martin hurried down to Belfast to publicly reassure Unionism that the soldiers of destiny harboured no desire to end partition. Hardly surprising, therefore, that Sinn Féin has found itself well placed to supplant Fianna Fáil, with a Labour Party that has spent so long in bed with Fine Gael and is now led by a TD who tried to bulldoze through the water tax legislation. The Social Democratic slot is vacant. Unsurprisingly, therefore, Mary Lou and colleagues are able to use that card to good effect. Moreover, with its repeated calls for a border poll, Sinn Féin can now lay claim to the Republican role once played by Fianna Fáil. That the prospect of Sinn Féin displacing Fianna Fáil is now a distinct possibility has been recognised by the power brokers of the Irish establishment, and they are reacting. After decades of outright hostility, the Sunday Independent recently dedicated 2 pages to an interview with Mrs. MacDonald. Last month, RTE's Joe Duffy spoke with her on the Meaning of Life programme, and perhaps most surprisingly of all, a retired Irish Army colonel aired the possibility of a Sinn Féin Minister of Defence for the 26 counties sometime in the near future. There is, though, about all of this, the impression of a coming to my parlour, said the spider to the fly strategy. The party can become acceptable to the establishment, but at a price. Whether the party would pay that price is a matter for its members. For the left, though, there is the need to recognise the emerging situation. And no matter what changes take place, that we keep our eye firmly on the goal of an independent and sovereign workers' republic.